Hello. As you can see, I spared no expense and we are getting started again with streams after about 5 years, Twitch told me. But 5 years, that's like nothing, nobody cares. And we're talking about rendering for 2D games. Very simple rendering, just splitting sprites on the screen. And of course, we are opening up some code because that's all we're good at. So you've probably seen that before. That is the simplest possible benchmark for 2D graphics. It just draws one simple image again and again and again. And how far can we get until the frame rate drops? 300,000. So that's not great. That's not too bad either. But the thing is, there's a lot of things out there which are much worse than that. There's a few things out there which are better than that. And what's even more important, this whole thing crashes down if you do a bit more than just rendering the same image again and again. And that's also the case for my software in a lot of different situations, even more so in my competition. And we will start working on that a little bit today. But more importantly, we will start looking into why it is that way. So, how do we do that? We start profiling. We start with the CPU. That's typically easier. So we have our parents again. We go up again. So we don't only see a computer waiting for VSync. We go up a bit more. Double. More than double. So let it run for a little bit. And close it. So we are working in Visual Studio here. There's a basic profiler integrated. Same goes for Xcode. And for Linux, you tell me. I don't know. But this one is relatively simple to use. And as you can see, it takes a lot of time to render things and not nothing else. Not very surprising so far. So and now we can see here things are happening because we're losing almost 40% in this step. It's maybe even nicer than call tree. It's caller callie. So here you can see Parrot's update takes time, about one third. What is it even doing? It's not doing that much actually. 5% in rand. Okay, we don't care about that right now. But this is just the code which updates the positions of the parrots in the benchmark. And this taking up 1/3 of our performance is already quite interesting, I think, isn't it? So let's go back and look at the other 2/3. There was a bit here, but not too much. So here's things are happening. And when we scroll down, we can see the actual transformation code, which takes some X and Y positions and transforms it basically for the GPU. This can also do rotations and stuff, which are not used in the sample, but would actually not really slow down things because it always does a complete matrix transformation. But you can see here that takes up quite some time. So it's our biggest time sink, but the time it spends when you scroll down here, it's actually spread out relatively evenly between the mask code and down here, the code which just puts the results in the buffers, which are then sent to the GPU. So that's to be expected, I think, that this is the biggest part of it. So that's relatively good, right? So let's look for those other 13%. Vertex buffer unlock. And here we see an actual bottleneck in Kink itself in the Direct3D backend. 11% in just a memcopy, which, what does it even do? So what's happening here is that some memory, which is used by D3D11, is mapped to, so basically we just get a pointer into something Direct3D manages for our vertices. And then we copy the data in we collected earlier, and then we unmap it. And just this memcopy takes up more than 10%. So the thing is, if I'm not mistaken, we could remove this completely. Because what's happening further up is we create a buffer here, then in our log function, we return that buffer or a part of it. And then in our unlock buffer, we copy from that buffer. Instead, we could just use this pointer we get here directly. So that would probably save us 10%. That would not get us to 1 million parrots, but it would help at least a bit. And yeah, so that's how you typically can relatively easy find big bottlenecks like that. But we are rendering, so is the CPU even our biggest problem here? Is another question you should ask. Because typically you think when you're rendering and it's getting slow, maybe your GPU is too slow to keep up. So the most basic test, we have a look at Task Manager. And there we see CPU is just 20%. Not too bad, not too good either. GPU actually looks kind of similar at 30%. So that doesn't tell us much because we don't see any details here. It's just, as far as I know, some number which the driver gives back to Windows. but we can see a little bit of details here by changing to the CPU core view. And what can we see here? It's, I'm not sure you can see it in the stream, but one of the cores is at 100%. It's a little bit darker blue than the other ones. You can see it when it, when I stop this for a moment, then this one core in the bottom right goes down almost completely. And now it goes up again. So that is our actual bottleneck here. We are bottlenecked by the CPU completely, but only on one core, because nothing in this whole thing, or almost nothing, is multi-threaded at all. So that's the biggest problem here. GPU didn't look that good either though. So let's have a quick look at our GPU with NVIDIA's tool. One thing about all those profilers is, okay, my mistake. It doesn't work correctly if I do not start Visual Studio as the root user. One moment. Back to the parrots. And we give it another try. Oh, we have to wait for it to show up. We have to wait some more. Come on. Computers are slow, you know. Not just when drawing parrots. Still not there. Still not there. And now. Okay, here we go again. This will work better, I hope. Get some parrots in again. Originally, this was, of course, a bunny mark. But nowadays, we're rendering parrots. We call it progress. So, press F11. And things are happening. So, this doesn't have very detailed views, but what's interesting is we have a lot of space here in the middle where nothing happens. And then we have some basic performance numbers here. So memory is at about 30%, texture units 20%. Shaders themselves at 30%. So it's kind of evenly spread out. So that's not too bad. Occupancy at 30%. That's a value showing you how much usage you actually make of your shader units. So that's not great, but also not totally terrible. Warp stalls. The warp is like the simped unit on the shaders. Stalls are not looking that bad either. So, and here we have a few of the, of all the calls we are doing to the GPU API, to D3D11 in this case. We can see on top here, we have 409 draw calls. That's okay. And when we sort by CPU, we can see that we see basically nothing. There's nothing which really takes a long time. It's all spread out. And if we look at the GPU, kind of similar. There's something. One random draw index takes longer. I didn't have that at my last go at this, so I think my GPU is just broken. But for the most part, all those draw calls are in a similar time range. So things are spread out and we don't see an actual bottleneck. Yeah, but the most interesting thing we're seeing here is this time where nothing happens. So on the GPU side, I think that kind of shows that we could do more. And there's one little proof of that. Let's see if I can quickly Google that. Where is it? I don't see it. Does anyone have the link for the Armory 3D bunnies really quick? Bunnies, 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 bunnies. I don't find it. Why is search so bad on Google websites? So then I just have to tell you about it. There's one tiny Armory 3D example, which is rendering bunnies and goes to 10 million or something. The link is here. Thank you. Yes, it's 10 million. So how does that even work when we only get to 300,000? So the thing is, our GPU profiling tool here sadly doesn't show us too much about it, but with optimizing that and getting everything out of the way on the CPU, you can actually get to those numbers. And that's really the big part of it, getting everything out of the way on the CPU. And if you remember what we saw there, we had, what was it, one third just calling. Just calculating the new positions for the bunnies, and then two-thirds, well, 10% for that oversight in my code, but the other 50% were math and copying data over. So in theory, all of that could be done by the GPU. You can also definitely calculate bunny positions on your GPU and can go much faster that way. The big downside of that strategy, though, is you typically won't do your game logic on your GPU. So it's interesting that you can draw that many bunnies on your GPU, but it's not what your typical two-day game can do because it just calculates where things go on the CPU. And even theoretically, it would be, I think, nearly impossible to do that on the GPU because for the GPU to go fast, everything needs to happen in parallel. And try to do that with your game logic. That's not easy. So, and typically, bigger games use those strategies to render lots of small 2D graphics, but for exactly the reasons we just talked about. They use it mainly for particle systems. So those particle systems then run completely on the GPU, including position updates. So that's the basics of that. And now we are starting to get into some code. So the whole series of streams we will be coding in C. Even so, I have a, well, we will do, today we will do a little bit of C++, but mostly we will be doing C with my kink library. And we will create the basic setup for that today. Basically, we will create the code so we can work in pure C from the next stream session on. And as you may or may not know, probably you know, I hope you know, this parrot mark I showed was done in hex and char. So the actual code for that looks a bit different. Looks like this and like, oh great. No, not like this. More like this. That then gets transpiled to C++, and that's what we just had a look at. And char has a small 2D API which does exactly the things we're interested in. And so does core, my C++ API, but my C API doesn't do that yet. So today we will just wrap the C++ API with some C code. So we have something to get started with and to do some measurements with and to compare our future experiments with. So this is the starting point for our C code. And now we will bring up the competing C++ code. And we will just wrap this. And for now, we will only do that to the actual image drawing, because everything else is mainly a copy and paste job from there on. So this means those are basically the functions we're interested in. And we also need a transformation. Do we need push rotation? Maybe. Set pipeline, we don't need custom pipelines yet. Scissor, we don't need scissors. Scissors are dangerous. Do you know the story of Conrad and the scissors and his thumbs? I hope not. It's scary. So we take this and go with it. So, and we also bring up King's other graphics APIs so we can look how things are looking there and do something which looks similar. So, king g4 set whatever, so it will be king g4 draw image. So, a bit of silliness here. G2 actually uses G4 textures as a type here, but we will go with that for now. Texture. Oh, that's wrong. That's actually wrong. This is better. Will it get non-red yet? Yes. So that's correct, that's correct, that's correct. Yeah, that's much the same. Ah, that's with the render target. Who needs that? I don't need that. We don't need that either. The matrix type in King is this one. So, do we even have want to have that here? We probably want to have that down here, I suppose. But we will see. I don't even know yet. And we want to implement our function. Done. So, we probably need to initialize things. Void, put in void. Because when you put in void in C, it actually can go a bit faster.
Ich spiele Peppe.
Boah, my iPad is playing music. iPad, go off. So I have an iPad lying here because I actually installed software to draw with it. And 2 hours ago, that actually worked. And then it stopped working. So when I draw something today, I will draw with a mouse, but that works too. Not four, it's two. And now we just want to wrap the other API, so we bring that in here. So, do we just create an instance of that? I guess so. Do we support want to support multiple instances of that? Maybe not. No, we can't put it on the stack because it has a constructor. Evil. Pure evil. Well, then it's going to be a pointer. Who cares for now? Because this is not how things are going to stay long term. We called it so, is that okay? No. Oh, I think, is it? Okay, whatever. So we are C++ here, so we can just do the evil thing. Oh, count completion, please. Yes. HD graphics. Render targets false. That's an okay default. So I think this will set things up. So it has a begin and an end function. Then we want to do that too. Otherwise, nothing will work. Any questions so far? Ah, I had no idea about void for func args. Yeah, I didn't know myself until recently, actually. But I read that up and saw a few samples of that. Basically, when you don't put in void, then C sets it up for a variable number of arguments. And when you put in void, you're basically telling it, yes, it's really nothing. Just basically a quirk of the language. Void. And with things like that, of course, you can never be sure that's still the case with the latest compiler version. And it can also always make a difference in C and C++. Whether your single compilation unit sees the whole thing when it compiles, or whether you have global optimizations, link time optimizations enabled. Because when the compiler sees everything that happens with some function, it can do optimizations it can otherwise not do. So now we just start. Calling things on the other thing. So, those defaults are hopefully okay. What can possibly go wrong, right? So, now we can do a quick test and check out whether this code crashes. Or whether it even compiles. Will it compile? It compiles. So, we still want to load an image. We will need an image. Images are good when you want to render images. We don't need that. Yeah. We make it green for now because we will need similar code. No, we don't. We just wrap the other thing. Right, then we can just get rid of it. And instead, we do kink g2 init. So we will still need our g4 begin here. Begin and end in core and kink are different to car. where you have to close the one and open the other, but in Core G2 was always a bit special in how you used it. So, will this run or will it crash? Hey, it runs. I didn't expect that, but it's okay. So, wouldn't that be King Matrix 3x3 underscore T instead? That is completely right. But also, it doesn't matter at all. So the thing is, that's another quirk of C. When we have a look at the definition, it's type def struct King Matrix 3x3 and then matrix 3x3 underscore t. We could also write this as two separate statements like this. This would be exactly the same thing. So we have a struct with this name and then we type def it to this name underscore t. And the whole reason for that is in C, you are not allowed to just type a struct name. This is illegal in C. It's okay in C++, but not in C. In C, you have to write it like this. And just for that silly reason, it's common to create lots of silly type defs, and then you don't have to write struct all the time. That's all there is to it. And here we are actually in C++, so it doesn't matter. But let's work ahead for when we switch everything to C. So it didn't crash. How is that even possible? Anyway, let's draw an image. So, hey, show me the other one. Or don't. So this will not compile because this is a king type and not a core type. So we are going to hack the system. Might actually be a little complicated because the core texture also has the image inside of it. But let's see. We can hack everything. So, image contains stuff. Most importantly, it includes a king texture, but then, that's how it contains an image. Look at that. I actually already put the hack. I just wanted to do it directly into the API. Okay, that's kind of funny. No core graphics texture. Can we just put it on the stack? I hope so. And you go in. It doesn't take a pointer. Why not? Oh, how unfortunate. How about we just change that? Don't tell anyone. I hope nobody but me used that so far. Probably something else will now stop compiling, but we can fix it. Is it just complaining about this? No. No. Expression must have. Pointer. Oh no, more, more. That's not great. That's not great. Hey, here takes a pointer at least. Yeah, of course it does. Not great, not great. Okay, we will just copy it and hope for the best. Where were we? We were here. Star. This does a copy, in case you didn't know. It's like, this is a pointer. C syntax is a little bit confusing. A star is a pointer, and a star on a pointer type basically copies what's behind the pointer to a stack variable. Yeah, so in practice, this makes a copy. So, text pointer. So, and maybe this will work. And maybe it will crash. So we have our texture. We have our G2 init. We have G2 begin. We should have our texture around still. Yes. Let's see what happens. Do you happen to know why it's treated like that in C? What do you what were you referring to, the structs and the type defs? Oh no. Oh, texture destroy. So that's not nice. Oh, yeah, it then destroys the copied texture and that's not exactly what we want. What do we do then? Something else. Stupid destructor. Nobody needs you. Let's make it more hacky. Does it have an empty constructor? No. It's typical C++ code. Looks like it's wrangling textures every time you draw an image. No, not really. It just, what I'm trying to do is just to hack together a core texture object in the cheapest way possible by just stumping the king texture in, basically. That's the idea. So this is not going to work, so we will make that a pointer. So this is initialized. This is all kinds of silly, but we just let it allocate the small texture itself. At the beginning, no, this is not the one. Yes, so and I don't think we need this one after all. So now we have that texture. Now it gets really hacky. And this will probably, yeah, it gets a width and height. Does it get anything else? Text width and text height. And then it remembers the texture, which will totally not work. Huh? But it will work for drawing at least one image, and that's all we want today, right? I don't tell anyone if you don't tell anyone. So, it uses width and height, and we can just set those. And the other ones are in here, I think. Yes, they are. Okay. Let's hack some more. Do I not have a width function? Oh. I thought I had. How unfortunate. Maybe we should add that. That seems quite. We don't have it because it's in here. Okay. Okay. That's fine. We just use the same for width and text width. Who cares? It's mostly the same anyway nowadays. The actual reason the code makes a difference between width and text width is to support older graphics chips, which can only do power of 2 texture sizes. But that's hardly a problem anymore today. But the GU2 renderer actually still supports that. which also makes the math more complicated and the renderer slower. Such a pity, but what can you do? So we have our texture, we hack our texture, we call draw image and hope for the best. Yes, that's not how you should write code, but that's how I write code. Oh, yeah, according to the chat, everybody understands what I'm doing, right? Let's try to move him around. Let's see if that works too. Ta-da! Okay. So no. That's it. We did this and it's working. And it's good enough for the bunny mark or the parrot mark. We can move an image. Oh, can we draw two images? I think we can. But we will make sure. Oh, and now they will be twice as fast, but that's okay. Yes, it's working. Slow them down again. Yeah, so that's working in the most silly way possible, but it's working. So where are we in my to-do list? Port that to kink. Yes. Okay, now we will port the actual bunny mark code. And then we talk a little bit more about what we can do with that in the future. So that is, okay, mouse down, update. There's an array of parrots. Okay, gravity, we probably need all of those things. Background color delta time. Okay, not too much code. We can't do draw string yet. Can you even see that? So that's better, I guess. We can't do draw string yet, but we don't care. We will do printf instead. Go through the array and draw image. This we can do. Okay, 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 okay. This hex thing is a dynamic array, but we are lazy. We will just create one gigantic array. Where is it again? There. And in there are the parrots. And where's the code for that? Yeah. Well, that doesn't look too complicated. Okay. And that's how you port hex to C. And we will do the same thing we have here with our type defs. Because this is an actual C file. So here it actually becomes a little bit important. Not really important, but a little bit important. So, lots of parrots. I think I will do an actual allocation for that. And so it's T. We only need it in here. That's why we make it static. What does that mean? Nobody cares. Initialize. So there's some memory we use for loading the image and for nothing else, I think. And we will just do another malloc. So size of how many parrots do we want to support? We want to support 10 million, 10, 10,000, 10 million. So, but we want to know, I guess, how many there actually are currently. So, any questions? Tile map is what? Somebody talked about something off topic. So, I just grabbed the chat in here. Sorry to expose you, but later on YouTube, nobody will know what you were writing. How to make beautiful API that also draws static geometry images. So you mean like not just rectangles, right? Is that what you mean? Beautiful API design. I don't know anything about that either. Dun, 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 dun. Persisting, I don't know. Tile map with static buffers. So static gem. Ah, what you are talking about is like not recreating the geometry all the time, right? Right? Right. Yes. Okay. I understand. So the reason I don't do it in car is basically that it's not like when you only dynamically create the geometry for, okay, let me start a little earlier. I think you are thinking of a typical 2D game where you have a tile map in the background and some sprites in the foreground. And yes, and when you only create something further. This how it is in car actually goes down to some work I did maybe 15 years ago, 20 years ago. Oh, I don't even want to know. Anyway, a long time ago. And I did some 2D game, which worked exactly like that. And it had really huge maps. And It turned out, in that case, it was better to just dynamically draw the tiles which are currently on the screen than creating static geometry for the whole level. So the bigger your levels become, the better it is to just create dynamically whatever on the screen right now, instead of creating this huge buffer and scrolling around in there. But that was a long time ago when video memory was actually smaller. But then again, if you think about it, how much time it takes to fill the screen with tiles and just the screen, that's maybe a millisecond, maybe two, if you do it like we are doing it here, and you can probably do better. So it's, you can still have a win from doing a tile map like that, but maybe less of a win than you think. And how would I do an API for that? Other engines or frameworks actually have that, and basically you would just have to expose the vertex buffer kind of and provide a function to create the data in there based on the tile indices. So you do you get that? Like you have, in any case, when you need one giant vertex buffer then for your whole level, and you provide a function to put your tile data in, and typically you will then not call that function at runtime, but at load time. And then you have a structure which you can just draw. Okay, where were we? Ah, we created a parrot array, which is the best kind of array. So this loads image, the font, we don't use the font, we have the array. Min x, ah yes, we need that as well. We eventually need the mouse, okay. We will do that last. Min x, min epsilon. In gravity. What's the B count? Is that the body count? I think that was initially the bunny count. You can go away now. Gravity. Load. Min-max, min-max, min-max. And, let's... Isn't that nice? So almost. Okay. We don't have our parent image yet. Ah, dum, dum, dum. Let's just put that here. And use that. So, we still have the wrong texture, but that's not too bad. Oh, my keyboard is out of power. We can fix that. Fixed. X is gone. Don't need it anymore. Okay, we have that, we have that, we have that. We have that. We didn't create any parrots yet, but that is correct. Mouse down creates the parrots. So let's use that. That's so, final no. Oh, we could differentiate the left and right mouse button. Okay, we just do this. Oh, we don't have fancy for loops in C. But who needs fancy? So, yeah, good news. We don't actually need to allocate any more parrots. We just need to, instead of this, we can just do this. Isn't that nice? Instance performance win by using C and having easy access to how memory is handled. So rand, we have kink rand, don't we? I think it's in math. Yes. What does it look like? Init, seed. What do we seed it with? Greenhide, argc? No. How about zero? Or how about kink time? How about kink time stamp? Ah, that's an int64, I think. Let's take kink time times 1000. Is that okay? Maybe. Nobody cares. So, kink random get. Get in min max. Oh, I think that's actually nicer. So I get, I guess hex random returns a number between 0 and 5. Between 0 and 1, and with times 5, we go to 0 to 5. So we just do this. And this goes from, oh, floats. Then we do, so this goes from 0 to 5, means, minus 2.5 to 2.5. Not even sure this supports negative numbers, does it? Hmm. I doubt it. So then let's go from 0 to 10. So is that the same? Just about, right? What is our parrot index? Parrots. This, I think, isn't it? We will find out, maybe, or maybe we will clobber some random memory. Beacon parrot. We already have that. So is that really all we need? Not quite right. I think this is better, isn't it? Yes. Is it possible to make game in C as fast as in Hex, for example? You are talking about development time, I think. It depends. It depends on your personal experience, and of course, and how good you know the programming languages. It depends on your team size. Like the big basic difference is that Hex is garbage collected and C is not, right? At least I think that's the most basic difference. And like from my personal experience, going garbage collected can save a lot of time in a bigger team. But when it's just you, not necessarily. But that depends on you. And just on you. So, we can create parrots. We will need our update loop. We will need our render loop. But that is pretty easy, I think. Do we even. This is just for. Showing the frame rate, I suppose. FPS, where does it come from? There. Okay. So we basically just need this. So that's. I don't even need to copy that. That's kind of the same as this. But it's not count, it is numParrots. And it's parrot.x. Where does that? That's probably happening here. Yes, parrot.x. And does parrot.x initialize somewhere? It's null initially. And speedx. We set speed x here, right? Then let's do this. We don't want to access any random memory. That's rarely what you want. With the exception of that one Atari game. What was that called? Which had random memory rendered in the middle of the screen on purpose. I always forget the name. But you can probably look it up. So that is parrots of i.x. dot epsilon, and that's how we render our parrots. You can go away. So right now we don't update the position, so they will all be in the top left corner, which is not very exciting, so we take the update code now. And we just put that on top of our rendering code. So let's iterate again. Parrot T. Pointer is address of the parrot. So now, so that's maybe a reason developing in hex is in some situations faster than developing in C. It's faster to type a dot compared to all those arrows. Especially now. What a pain. Actually, I think there's no good reason for that to be an arrow instead of just being a dot independently of whether it's a pointer or not, or random. But you know, C is old. Older than I am, even. So, king, random, something. Get in. Oh, more random. Such a pity. 3. Like that. If the random calls are slightly off, we will never find out. Update. Draw. Create parrots. So parrots are initialized here. Down here. So what do you think? Will this work? Probably not. But I think we're already close. Some conversions from float to int, double. That we can at least fix quickly. Let's give it a try. And look at it, it just works. On first try. Like it always does when I code something. Let's use the correct traffic. Parrot ping. Parrot mark. A small parrot, it's a small parrot. Small parrot. Small parrot. Ta-da, ta-da. Is that right? Or are our random functions off? I feel like they are off. But at least we have a lot of parrots on the screen. Let's implement the mouse clicks. Any questions so far? Use ReSharper C++. It will. Maybe Visual Studio can also do that. Maybe Visual Assist can also do that. Oh, or maybe I actually switched that off because it sometimes doesn't detect it correctly. That's something I remember. So, could it just be because it's assigning ints to velocities? Oh, ints to velocities, velocity, speed. But speed is float. Yeah, that's kind of a thing in hex. When you do a division of two integers, it becomes a double. That's not the case in C, but I don't think we had a division here. I think that was also just integers. But we will see in a moment. I want to add the mouse click first. Input mouse. No, not internal. Ah, kink mouse press callback. Yeah, that's just about what we need. And why is it red down here? Oh, okay, it's just slow. Create parrots and go away. No, see, auto completion. It always messes things up. Ten thousand, right? 10,000 on the left click. We don't need to go slow, but like this. Okay. Give it a try. Ooh, and it works. And it's weird and slow. Is it slow? Yes. It's very slow. We will look into that. So, do I want to debug the random code now? It's kind of random, you know. Let's understand what's going on. Are they really, what I'm wondering is, are they really all starting at zero all the time when they are created? Yes, looks like it. Okay. Gravity, that works. So that gets the speed down. Does that work correctly? Do we ever go in here? No, we don't. Ah, yes, we do. It works, I guess. And next time we go in there. Next time. We go in there. Next time. We don't go in there. It's perfect. Wow, excellent. That one works. Let's look at the warnings. Looking at the warnings can be a good idea sometimes. Double to in, that's boring. So, no, that's okay. Something wrong with those, maybe? Don't think so. How about we just make them floats in the first place? Float. Doesn't change a thing. But it gets rid of not very interesting warnings. So, no, that's okay too. Well, mostly it's kind of. Yeah, it's kind of different because the original code can also. Oh, that might. Ah, yes, this explains it. Yes, exactly like you're saying. They are aligned to our 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So, let's do 500 divided by 100 and something like that. How about it? Yes, that is correct. So, see, the warnings actually led us to the correct line to fix. And wow, is it slow. Okay, we are in debug mode, though. But it's all working, right? Apart from it being super slow, it's working. Let's do a release build. Can delete that line. Any other crap still around? That comment is okay. Yeah, looking fine, looking fine. Are we done? Still not done. I need a faster computer. For now, don't profile your code in debug mode. Unless it's about making debug mode faster. Oh, we have one warning left. But I was not fast enough. We will catch it next time. Are we running? Yes. That's better. That's much better. Aha. Now it's getting slow. How many apparents are there? Let's print some numbers. Update. We have lock included. Did you know that in Windows, in Visual Studio, by default, you can't see the output of a printf in the debugger? It's great. But with kinglock, it works. Let's do something silly and count the frames. And So this is just so we don't get too many printfs. Oh, the warning, the one. So $180,000 and it's still looking good. Yes, we are actually, and now it's getting slow. Yeah, we are in the same performance ballpark we were in before, which is as it should be, because the G2 code in core is actually a port of the car port done by my former research assistant, the cat lady. So, so she did well. It works as fast as the original, just about. So let's have a quick look at the performance. Where's the window? It. Oh, so. Parrots, parrots. Do I still have my output? I need to see how many there are. Oh, it doesn't show my output when I'm in the profiler. That's unfortunate. Let's just click until it gets slow. Yeah. Now it's slow. Let's make it more slow. Okay. Collect some data. Okay. Oh, the parrots kill the stream. Yeah, that's how I want it. Yeah, it's selected. Let's go to my favorite view, draw buffer, set track color. Yeah, who cares? So we again see random. I should change the random function. Really, it's not good. So we spend 30% in here, just about, because we lose it between here and here. So that is draw image. Let's have a look. And surprise, surprise, it's basically the same code we saw earlier. The Cindy code. So that's pretty similar. And in here is the code which copies the data. We saw that earlier too. But earlier we saw the code after hex already did some inlining, so that's the reason the structure is kind of different, but the numbers are similar, and that is nice. Don't drop buffer, and we are again in our unlock function, and we take another path. Look at that. the vertex buffer is not set as dynamic. So that's not right. That we can fix. And suddenly things will be a bit faster. Ta-dum. Where's the code? Oh, that's not where I wanted to be. C profilers are nice. They help a lot. Where's our vertex buffer? There's a vertex structure, though the buffer can't be that far. Ah, that's just for compiling the pipeline. Buffer size. buffer index. Init buffers. That sounds like there might be some buffers. Aha. So. Tada. Almost fixed. Now it likes it, yes. Let's give it another try. Here you are. Clickety 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 click 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 clickety click. Of course it would be reasonable to just set a constant amount of parrots in the code. But whatever, we are just playing around. It's fun clicking parrots. Wait a few seconds. Okay. And now I hope we will again see our memcopy as a bottleneck. As a 10% bottleneck. Unlock. Look at it. Oh no, it's a 22% bottleneck, which might mean that the other code is a bit more efficient, or maybe the amount of parrots is just different and that throws things off. But, you know, things are around about the same. It's quite similar. And I quite like that. So we are now in the same situation we were before. But we now have some C code to do it. So from now on, we can just keep this code around and just replace this code, which, as you can see, is not a lot of code, but of course that's because it just wraps some other code. But this other one, if you just look at the image painter, that goes from line 20, still the image painter, still the image painter. Oh, it's bigger than I thought. Ah, the different draw image functions, which we didn't even implement here. So below 300 lines of code, and a lot of those lines are pretty boring, like those lines, or look at this, very boring lines of code. More boring lines. Should it be zero? Maybe, I don't know. More boring code. See, mostly boring code. Because, and did I even explain that? I think I did, right? What didn't I? So the basic procedure, let's draw something. No, I wanted it to be black. Yes. So let's talk about GPUs and CPUs a bit, about how they work and cooperate and stuff. Is that now? Yes. And yes. So this I wanted to draw on my iPad, which is not cooperating. So now you have to witness how good or bad I am with in drawing with a mouse. But I guess you can read it. CPU, GPU. So those are our things which do things and in the end draw the parrots to the screen. So, and yeah, let's talk about the basic procedures. You maybe know how a CPU works. It does actually very simple things. That font might be a little bit too big. Basically, it has instructions to. My iPad is talking again. It's so horrible. I will switch it off just a moment. And then when I boot it again, I will switch that whole stupid speech thing off. Doesn't even want to. Okay, you know what I do? I'll just throw it away. Just a moment. Yeah, you're not. Oh, I didn't think you heard that, but when I walked out with the iPad, it actually said, I'm not sure what you mean. But now it's gone. So, what your CPU does, basically, it has instructions and registers, which are tiny pieces of storage space for numbers, which it uses to calculate things. And it has instructions to store register values in memory at some address. Can typically also just put some number there. And can load data from memory into some register, and it can do some basic math on it. And it can do conditional instructions, like go to some address, or compare registers and maybe do a jump to somewhere when they are equal or whatever. The actual instructions for jumping around conditionally, there's a bunch of them and they are different, but it's kind of this. It can store data to memory, it can load data from memory, it can do some math, and it can jump around in the code based on other things. And that's basically all it can do. And as you can see here, a lot of that is about memory, so that seems to be kind of important. And apart from it doing this stuff, it can now do a bunch of this stuff in parallel. You probably know your CPU now is a multi-core CPU, and it also has SIMD instructions to, which are kind of like something like this. And then you have four numbers in this register. So there's two methods of or like two manual methods which you programmatically do to do things in parallel. And that's what a CPU does, at least what it looks like from the outside. Internally, there's of course more going on to make things fast. And the GPU is kind of split in two, because there's can't be bigger than the actual GPU, but this thing here is the command processor. And this here are the shader units. Or you could also call them basically the cores, because that's kind of similar to the cores in your CPU. And the command processor kind of gets the things you call in your GPU API, like draw indices or set shader to this address or clear the screen. And the command processor takes these instructions and then prepares that somehow for the shader cores, and then those go off and calculate that in parallel. And the way the shader cores do that in parallel is actually quite similar to how CPUs do it. They also have those wide instructions, those SIMD instructions, but they typically go wider than on a CPU, like maybe 16 times or 32 times. And there's just a whole bunch of them, and also typically more than in a CPU, like maybe 32 or 64 or something like that, or even more. And this parallelism on the GPU works much better than it typically works on your CPU with your typical programmer, at least. Because in the GPU, all that parallelism is achieved semi-automatically by the programming model, by the shaders. Because instead of actually programming all the things which are happening in here, you just provide small pieces of callback code, which are then called for each vertex or each pixel, or also some other things nowadays. And that code, due to the restrictions also of the shader language, is usually done in a way which is trivially parallelizable by just disallowing, well, not completely disallowing, but like the way you usually write it, you don't just access pieces of memory which another shader invocation also invocates. You're kind of like, the whole model is built in a way that quite naturally you write code that then always works on one little piece of memory, and when all invocations are done, all the pieces of memory you want to work on are done. And there's further restrictions. You typically can't do recursion in shader code. And you may have heard that if and else are slow. And the reason for that is that shader compilers automatically, from normal code that by itself doesn't look parallel, but they automatically compile it into code that's basically only using those write instructions. And yeah, those write instructions work on multiple elements at once. And that, of course, becomes a problem when the code paths in those four elements in this example diverge. And how that's usually done is by moving through the if and else blocks and just masking the, it's called typically called lanes, just the parts of the registers which are not affected in the if or else branch. So on a typical GPU, you get the, when you try to early out your in your code with an if, that doesn't work properly. It only works on the core level, but not properly on the single lanes inside of the core. So that's the reason for that. So, and now we have our CPU and our GPU. And when we now render things, we send data from the CPU to the GPU, right? But the thing is, that's not how computers work. You can't really, in a computer, send data from one chip to another. You can do a bit of that with interrupts, if you want to look that up, but that's not suited for sending bigger amounts of data. And even the amount of data for this command processor with the commands like draw some stuff, that's not working like that. Instead, there's this other block in your computer and it's called memory, and it's quite important. So how communication between CPU and GPU actually works is the CPU writes something into memory and the command processor in the GPU it just looks whether some memory address changed, maybe. Or maybe there's a bit, little bit of direct communication to kick off the command processor. But when it's kicked off, latest at that moment, it will have a look at some memory and patch the instructions which the CPU put in there. And the same is for all the other things you want to send to the GPU from the CPU. Your vertex buffer goes somewhere into memory, and then at some point some shader cores will read it. Same for images. You put them somewhere into the memory, and then the texture units inside of your shader cores will read it. But maybe you have a PC with a PCI Express card, and then it becomes even more complicated because that's not a box. Because then you have your VRAM. And then what actually happens is that your GPU, maybe it's not even the shader cores, but some DMA unit. This will read the data from memory. Ideally, not so often, and then put it in here. And then the shader cores will read it. But actually, it's even more complicated than this, because since the early 90s, memory doesn't look like this anymore. Instead, no. Instead, you have memory and you have your CPU cache 1 and your CPU cache 2. And by default, when you write some code with your CPU, it will just go into cache 1 and your GPU will never know about it. So when you want to want your GPU to see this, you have to do a cache flush. And you know what? The GPU has memory caches as well. So the whole problem exists here as well. What I'm basically saying here is shuffling data around between the CPU and the GPU is a complicated process and a process that's typically not completely automatic on the hardware side. Like, you probably know that about CPU caches. Even when you have multiple CPU cores and you write something into CPU cache 1 or into the level 1 cache or level 2 cache or however they are called, and then another code reads from the same address which just went into the CPU cache, this works automatically. That's called cache coherency, and that's actually a pretty fancy hardware feature of your CPU. But typically, you don't have cache coherency between CPU and GPU. So this cache flushing and all this stuff here, that's either done by the driver or by you, or typically a combination of both. And the big problem about this is how complicated this communication is, because it becomes even more complicated when you actually send commands in here with a memory that belongs to it. Then it happens fairly often that the CPU needs to know whether the GPU is done with this piece of memory, because the CPU needs to know whether it can reuse this or not. And yeah, that's a very basic overview of the problems of communication between CPU and GPU. And on PCs, this becomes even more complicated because there's the graphics driver in between all of that. So in some situations, you can't just put something in here and let the GPU grab it and use it. For example, textures. Different GPUs want their textures internally in a different format to work as fast as possible. So when the textures are copied over here, either the driver or a special unit in the GPU or whatever will have to do additional work on memory to convert your textures and all kinds of stuff like that. And your shaders have to be converted. And your here, your command buffers also have to be converted for your specific GPU when you're on a PC or a mobile phone or anything where the details of the GPU can vary. So there's just lots and lots of work and complications and lots of situations where one has to wait for the other when both of these communicate. And basically what I'm trying to say is when you code something like a 2D graphics renderer, the most likely performance bottleneck you will run into is this mess. This is the most common performance culprit in when you get started with doing something like that. And maybe you remember our inside captures from earlier today where the GPU didn't do anything for quite a while. That seems to be kind of a related issue to this. So that is like the most important thing to make graphics fast nowadays. To make sure that communication between CPU and GPU is efficient. So that they don't wait on each other. And even if they don't wait on each other, you can still get into big CPU performance problems when you're even if you're just rendering stuff, because all of the preparation that has to be done for your data to prepare it for your GPU, especially when there's a driver in between you and the GPU. There's a question in the chat, how much of this can be mitigated with G5? The thing about G5, or if we're not talking in terms of my own APIs, what can be mitigated with something like Vulkan and D3D12 is that a lot of this is handled manually in these APIs. So you can, in those APIs, actually decide when to wait on something. That's you have to make sure that that works correctly. Not yet in my API, but in D3D12 and Vulkan, you can also freely decide where data goes. Like, do I want the GPU to directly read from memory over the PCI Express bus? Do I want to copy in VRAM first? All those steps are also manual in those APIs. So you cannot avoid this mess, but you can manage it yourself in those APIs. And those, that has two big advantages. First, no, even three. It has three big advantages. First, you directly see what's going on. Second, what's going on stays the same. And that's rather important. It's quite annoying when OpenGL driver on system 1 does it this way and OpenGL driver on system 2 does it that way. And the third one is you have the means of really optimizing most aspects of that manually. So that's exactly what those new APIs are all about. So now, how does that relate to what we are currently doing to render our 2D graphics. What's currently happening, let's create a new image. Yes, that's an important image, right? I think I want that in my PhD. So. We always draw on black so nobody goes blind, right? At least I like that more. Yeah, how does rendering currently work? Currently, the renderer allocates one big vertex buffer. And as we have seen earlier, the renderer actually does more on the CPU than you normally would think it does. In particular, it does all the position transformations on the CPU. Normally, you would do that on the GPU in your vertex shader. But we will get to the reason I do it that way in just a moment. So in that vertex buffer, we have positions, hex cohorts, and colors, because the renderer supports tinting your images. And that is just a big old buffer for, I don't know, maybe for 10,000 elements. And when we draw an image, it does the calculates the final positions, and then it just throws the data in here. So, and the nice thing here is, for this step, there is zero communication between the CPU and the GPU. It just puts some data into some memory. So that is pretty fast, and there's no problem with that. And at some point, the buffer is full. And when that happens, it issues a draw call. And then restarts the buffer. And now it gets interesting. Both of these happen when the buffer is full, of course. Indenting didn't quite work out, whatever. So it does a draw call. That is, of course, a little bit of GPU communication. But that's not too bad. But then what's bad is that it restarts the buffer because it doesn't know when it can restart the buffer. So the whole thing runs on old GPU APIs like OpenGL and D3D 11 and on the new APIs as well. And on the old APIs, this buffer reuse, this just works magically automatically. That means your OpenGL driver in the background does things to allow you to reuse that vertex buffer right away for some definition of right away. That can mean, in the worst case, that it just waits around until everything is done with that buffer. And that would be really bad. In the best case, it will, in the background, without you seeing it, create multiple copies of that vertex buffer. And when we then write data into that vertex buffer again, it just, without us even noticing, writes that into another buffer while the first buffer is still in use. And when this whole thing runs on Vulkan with our API, that's exactly what happens in the background. The wrapper around the G5 APIs creates multiple vertex buffers for vertex buffers which are created in G4 with a dynamic marker. And when a buffer is in use and you use it again, it just switches to another buffer. Of course, this only works because you're not reading from that buffer, you're only ever writing to it. And when this buffer reuse, when that works out properly, then the thing is fast. If the OpenGL driver doesn't do that properly, then our 2D renderer is dog slow. And we've seen that on Android. So, but there's other things which also on proper drivers or on the new APIs can make this procedure very slow. Because buffer full is not the only situation in which the draw call and the buffer restart are issued. This also happens when the texture that is used to draw the image is different from the last image. And the reason is, let's open the shaders. Painter image frog. Oh, great. Okay, here you can see there's a texture reference, or maybe we look at the source code. No, that's not the right one. That's not the right one. It's kind of similar, but that's not actually this one. There. This is the texture. The reference to the texture, which is then used in our pixel shader to actually draw the image pixel by pixel. And when we have a look at our source code again, in the trailers and buffers, set texture, draw buffer, yeah. So the thing is, in old APIs, you require one API call to set your texture. And so you can't, in your shader, just freely switch between all the different textures you have somewhere. Instead, you have to only draw until you need another texture. Then you have to do a set texture call, and then you can go again. So when the texture, when we use lots of different images to draw, this basically cancels out our nice strategy we have here. This all falls down, and things will be very slow again, because we will lots and lots of draw calls and lots and lots and lots and lots of buffer reuses until even the best driver cannot keep up with its kind of randomly created background buffers. So that's pretty bad, and that's how it is currently. But there's, of course, nowadays things we can do about that. One strategy that works with all the hardware is we could actually use more than one texture in here. And then we would have to throw some more data into our vertex shader. Kind of like this, and then throw it out. This is not supposed to be code that actually works, just pseudo code. And here you see that, of course, doesn't quite work. They should have different names. And then you get that in your pixel shader. And then you basically do if, like null, zero, then you use text zero, else if, and so on. And hopefully the shader compiler is not completely stupid with that, but if you use a lot of different images, this actually works to speed up things considerably, really. And of course you would like to use as many textures as your GPU actually supports at once in one shader. Sadly, that number varies per GPU, so you will probably compile different variations of your shaders for different GPUs to make that as fast as possible on different GPUs. Yeah, question in the chat, how would that be a benefit over using bigger textures? Completely true. Instead of switching between different textures, you could, of course, just throw everything into one giant texture, and that way you get rid of the problem. But I'm looking at that from the view of my API and the way it's implemented now. The burden is on the application developer to create those huge images. And it would be nicer if that would not be necessary, right? And on modern GPUs, actually, it isn't necessary, which is a thing. And also from a more practical perspective, like when you do all the code anyway and don't care about the bigger images, first there's size restrictions for the size of images, for the maximum size, and again different sizes on different GPUs, and throwing everything into a big image doesn't work that nicely with mid-mapping. So when you want to also scale down your images, that is not so nice. So If what? Ah, Voxel Engine Mipmap Issues. Yes, you can have multiple spreadsheets. Yes, of course, of course. You can prepare your data, but we are trying to build something here where you don't have to. And you're right that you don't necessarily need that because you can prepare your data. But still, I want people to be able to just do lots of image draw calls, and I want it to be fast in every situation. And the thing is, modern GPUs have, or modern GPU APIs have a feature called bindless texturing, where the GPU itself can decide which texture to use, and you just register, basically, you just register your textures with a number. And in pseudocode, how that looks like is, yeah, basically it's like this. You still put a number in, but instead of this if and else, and even this goes away, you do something like this. And this is what you can actually do today. And the problem is just gone. And this is more or less difficult on different APIs. And I haven't put this into kink yet, but we will do that during the course of these streams. And then spreadsheets just don't matter anymore, and you hope you agree that that's a nice thing. Don't you? I hope you do. So, and when that is done, basically, this goes away, and this doesn't really matter that much because we can just make the buffer so big that it doesn't matter anymore in practice. So then our bottlenecks that remains are actually this one then the application code, which actually calculates things and calls draw image, that's a bottleneck. And yeah, this arrow here is a bottleneck too, because we have to write a lot of data and then the GPU also has to read a lot of data. So at some point, this goes over the PCI Express bus when you use a PC. So that's our remaining bottlenecks. And over the course of the streams, we will also look at what we can do with with those. Of course, one option we also talked about earlier is to just put all of that into the GPU, but it's not a practical option for all the things you want to draw, but we will still have a look at it as an option. And then, of course, these things here run on the CPU. And we have multiple CPU cores, So maybe we can make use of that and put as little as possible burden on the thread which actually does the draw image calls. So I'm not yet sure how that will work out, but we will try to move this stuff and this stuff to another thread, or even multiple threads. And maybe we can also, yeah, for sure, but well, at the current state, for sure, but we will see how much we can minimize the amount of data we put in here. Yeah, and that's one of our targets for this whole endeavor. But of course, this series is called the best and the worst strategies of rendering for 2D games. So we will, that will be one thing we do, but we will also do lots of other things. Next month, actually, I don't want to go further into this yet. Instead, I want to start episode 1 with writing a software rasterizer and getting the most out of that. And something I'm actually interested in seeing is when we do the most, the worst possible situation for what we currently have by just switching the textures all the time, will our software rasterizer in that situation actually be faster than what we do with our GPU? Maybe, I don't know yet, and we will find out. So we will next time start writing a software rasterizer, and the month after we will try to optimize the hell out of that thing and see how far we get. Then we will probably do the reasonable things like what I just talked about and optimize our GPU pipeline. And then it will be off to crazier things like how about writing a 2D graphics rasterizer completely via compute shaders? What problems will that uncover or maybe solve? And of course, we will also use a dual ray tracing 2D renderer. Because why not, right? It's sure to be slow, and that's fun. So, and that's what I wanted to talk to about today. Yeah, and it's already 2.5 hours. So, do you have any questions? Ooh. Software rasterizer is appreciated. That's nice. If Kink uses multiple cores, is it still usable from car? Yes, in this case, yes, because that would be behind the draw image API. So car wouldn't actually see what's going on there. I guess the question comes up because I quite often talk about how multithreading in Hex is sadly kind of problematic and not that well supported. But that is not an issue if it happens inside of Kink, because then the Hex side just doesn't see it. And that's how it will be for this code. That's how it currently is for audio in CrossCode. Not yet in regular car, but that's just because I haven't merged that over yet. And it's already the same for loading files. That is also in car when you compile to C++ and you load an image or a sound file or whatever. That happens on a different thread, and the hex side is just notified when the data is ready. It's kind of like you have the GPU that looks at some data and the CPU, and that has to be synchronized with the GPU. And hex is, the hex code is like the third element, which also somehow communicates with the C side of things. And sometimes it communicates directly, but sometimes it's more like CPU, GPU communication, and the hex side of things basically just gets a notification when things are ready. Ah, how do we will we be able to access the code for the experiments? Yes, I think creating branches for kink will be the right thing, and the parrot mark, I will also put that into a GitHub repository here. It will all be different repositories and branches and stuff. So, any more questions? Yeah, cheers. Okay, so that's it for today. I plan to do this monthly, and yeah, starting from next month, I will try my best to make all this like, we will continue to work in C, we will continue to work with kink, like with my APIs and stuff. But I will try to make the kink part of it rather small and do everything in a way that it's also applicable to non-kink. So anybody who's interested in rendering and games and optimization and all those things and GPU stuff can follow and understand what's going on. And maybe that way we will actually get some more viewers. Who knows? We can try at least. Okay, so that's it for today, and I hope to see you next month again. Bye-bye.